Iya sih, bahaya, tapi kami pengemudi yang baik dalam pengendaraan penting banget, pasti untuk pertama nyawa.
Every successful business starts with a great idea. Today, moving from concept to reality is easier than ever before. Join us as we travel around the world to meet developers, architects, and innovators to learn how they're building on the AWS cloud. Welcome to This Is My Architecture.
This is Jakarta, the capital of Indonesia, located in the northwest corner of the most populated island in the world.
Rapid urbanization, coupled with competitive investment in infrastructure, has made traffic pretty intense around here. That means getting to a hospital can sometimes take hours.
And that's just the travel time. Hospital queues can be so bad, some people make a living holding a place in line for others. In Indonesia, there's only 2 doctors for every 10,000 people. It's no wonder most Indonesians only consider going to the doctor when they're really sick.
So what if there was a way to see a doctor without having to get onto these busy streets? Let me show you.
Hello, Adrian. So I'm Dr. Nisa. Tell me how you feel today.
Well, Dr. Nisa, I was, outside today. It's quite a warm day and just outside under the
this
sun.
This is Halodoc, a company and app that allows you to interact with a doctor right from your phone.
So how is Halodoc good for your patients?
So, in Indonesia, there are many people live in rural areas, right? And they have restricted access to healthcare facilities. Some would have to travel like hours to get to the nearest healthcare facilities. So with Halodoc, you can just minimize the travel things. And then like in Jakarta, you have traffic jams all over the place, right? So you don't have to travel. And you get to reduce the waiting time to get to the healthcare facilities and go to the doctor.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Doctor, for helping me today.
Thank you, Adrian. Hope you get well soon.
Thank you.
An app that makes it possible for a country of 264 million people with 50% internet penetration must have some serious technology behind it.
And now I'm going to find out how it works.
This is the nerve centre at Halodoc, where right now dozens of doctors are fielding inquiries from all around the country. As an island nation, 80% of calls are coming from outside the city, where access is much more difficult.
Beberapa minggu yang lalu, ayah aku ke kota naik motor. Di sana dia diserempet mobil, masuk got, terus pingsan. Dan setelah dia sadar, dia tetap melanjutkan perjalanan sampai bisa pulang ke rumah. Dan pas di rumah, ayah aku cerita kalau kejadiannya seperti apa. Dia bilang dia nggak apa-apa. Dia cuma sedikit pusing, dan dia cuma mau tidur. Saat itu pun aku juga mau berangkat kerja. Tapi aku takut untuk ninggalin ayah aku sendiri. Karena aku nggak tahu kondisinya seperti apa.
So what did you do?
Aku download aplikasi Halodoc.
And to learn about how all this works, I'm joined by Abilesh, the Chief Technology Officer for Halodoc. Hey Abilesh, thanks for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
So I'm really keen to get underneath the covers of the architecture, but before we do that, tell us a little bit about how it all started.
At Halodoc, we started building our tech stack about 3 years ago. Our initial version was a simple monolith, one compute backed by a simple database.
Wow. And obviously, things have changed since then as you've continued to grow. So walk us through some of those changes.
Since our inception, Halodoc has started launching new business lines. One of the business lines is you can buy medicines online. Second business line is you can talk to doctors online. As and when we started launching new business lines, it was obvious to us that a monolith will not cut it, and we had to go the microservice route as soon as possible.
So it sounds like all these new interactions that your users were having became new microservices in your architecture.
Each microservice has a couple of compute instances backed by persistence. We use RDS, MySQL database. So one group could be buying medicines online, the second group could be talking to a doctor online, and so on and so forth. At the moment, we have 40 to 50 microservices on production.
So you've gone from using a single class of EC2 instance to now having multiple different classes based on user interactions. Given that each of these microservices have their own databases, I'm keen to understand, how did you think about data partitioning?
For certain use cases, we had to ensure that the data is consistent across different microservices. A good example is users' data. As a user, you could buy medicines or talk to a doctor, and these belong to different microservices. So what we did is we used DynamoDB to save all of our user data.
So imagine all of these services would use identity quite often. So having a low latency database and being able to share that across all these microservices is a big benefit.
Yep.
Now, I see another service there, the simple notification service, something that we see quite often in microservices architectures. How are you using it?
So when we started our microservice journey, I believe it was when we had about 10 microservices on production, we started noticing that we were having unnecessary tight coupling between our microservices. One microservice would know about the other microservice and would do a sync call, right? So we wanted to kind of avoid that and bring in the asynchronous flexibility. So we essentially decided to build an event bus, and that's where the SNS journey started.
Now, you've obviously gone from virtual machines to microservices, but I see you've even gone even further, and you're using serverless technology. So I'm keen to understand, what is Lambda doing over here?
Let's take an example. Let's say you spoke to a doctor, and doctor issued an electronic prescription to you, right? So the consultation service would raise an event into SNS, and SNS would trigger the Lambda.
Right, so you're using Lambda to go and, you know, curate some of the data in your event bus, but also to create some stuff here as well.
And then, so the Lambda enriches the event raised. It pulls medicine names, the doctor name, the patient name, and then generates the PDF, which can be used by the patient to buy medicines.
Fantastic. Now, what is this second Lambda doing over here?
So one of the business use cases we had is real-time visibility on how certain metrics are doing. For example, availability of a doctor, how many consultations a doctor is doing, and so on and so forth. That was a requirement from the business side. So the way we solved it is each of these microservices would raise events. It would go into SNS. From SNS, we would send it to Lambda. Lambda would do the enriching we spoke about earlier. And once the data is enriched, it would go into Kafka. And on top of Kafka, we built Flink, then an Elasticsearch, and then Grafana for visualization.
The genius of Halodoc was a merging of a network of doctors and pharmacists. They connect 22,000 doctors and 1,500 pharmacies across 50 cities in Southeast Asia.
After a teleconference with a patient, doctors upload the medical prescriptions to the pharmacists where they can be picked up and delivered. Good morning.
Good morning.
So, Elisa, how has Halodoc changed your pharmacy business?
Manfaat Halodoc untuk apotek saya jadi mendapatkan pelanggan baru yang tadinya tidak pernah datang kemari.
So how is it easier for your patients?
Untuk pasien kemudahannya karena mereka dapat mendapatkan obat yang mereka perlukan tanpa harus datang ke apotek. Kemudian transaksi juga lebih mudah.
That's great. So how does it all work?
Sangat praktis sekali karena kami akan mendapatkan order lewat aplikasi ini. Kemudian kami menyiapkan obat yang diperlukan. Dan Gojek akan datang mengambil obatnya.
So these are the Gojek drivers. They're the ones that pick up the medicines that patients need and deliver them right to their front door. And Teddy over here,
thank you, sir,
is going to show me just how it's done. Let's go. These Gojeks are small, swift, and very maneuverable. They can get potentially life-saving medication to patients in under 40 minutes. No wonder they're so popular. And it's all part of a growing sector of the economy, ride-sharing. The other expanding sector of the Indonesian economy is e-commerce. Each has increased by 60% over the last 5 years. And Halodoc is riding both those waves.
So, Abhilash, it's clear that Halodoc really deals with a lot of data, not just in volume, but also in type. Let's start with what you do with the transactional data.
So from all the individual RDSs, we are moving the data into Redshift using DMS.
To the database migration service?
Yes. And on the Redshift, the business analyst can run queries for like monthly reports or weekly reports and things like that.
Fantastic. Obviously a very scalable data warehouse solution there. Now, how do you keep that RDS instance performant?
We want to ensure that medical records are saved. We want to ensure that historical record is kept safe. So the way we do it is from RDS, older data gets moved into Glacier for record keeping.
Now, I imagine a lot of your analysts want to ask questions about how the business is operating. Tell me a little bit about how you help them.
Good question. So let's say I'm an analyst who's responsible for ensuring that there are enough doctors on the platform. I want to know how many doctors are online at the given moment. For this, we built out a real-time pipeline. So the data from Kafka gets ingested into Elasticsearch, which acts as the persistent layer. And for the visualization, that's what the analyst is going to use. We are going to use Kibana and Grafana.
I've noticed that you're using a lot of open source software here. Why is that?
Open source, there were two reasons. One is the comfort the developers have with the tool. And second is the customizability and the flexibility these tools offer.
When I was using the app, one of the things I really liked was the different ways I can actually interact. And one of those ways is I could actually upload photos. Let's dig into how you manage that large image repository.
Sure. Let's say you're talking to a doctor, a dermatologist in this case, and you have a skin rash. So in the app, you take a photo of your skin and upload it to a S3 bucket. Right. So once the image is uploaded to an S3 bucket, so it kicks in the image recognition algorithm, where we try to determine whether this is medically relevant or not.
So why are you actually filtering the images?
We want to ensure that the doctors on our platform do not get inappropriate images from the users.
And recognition is automatically trained to be able to remove potentially unsafe images in the repository.
Yes, when we checked it on our data set, we found that we didn't have to retrain the model because recognition did a very good job of classifying the images.
Dan setelah kecelakaan itu, ayahku cuma mau tidur. Aku kasih tahu ayahku untuk jangan tidur terus. Sebelumnya aku belum pernah pakai aplikasi Halodoc. Dan setelah aku coba download, ternyata aplikasinya cepat dan mudah. Hanya dalam hitungan menit, aku bisa berbicara dengan dokter. Aku menjelaskan keluhan-keluhan yang ayahku alamin. Dan dokter menyarankan aku untuk bawa ayahku ke rumah sakit. Aku nggak tahu kalau aku nggak download aplikasi Halodoc. Apa nyawa ayah aku bisa tertolong atau enggak. Aku sangat berterima kasih dengan aplikasi Halodoc.
Healthcare is not a single product, but a series of interactions between patients, doctors, pharmacists, and drivers. This is all previously done by hand. Halodoc had to create all the connecting tissue to make it work.
Abhilash, 5 million users in just 3 years. You're changing the face of healthcare in this country. But I'm curious to understand, what were some of those challenges that you've had to overcome along the way?
When we started building technical solutions for business problems, we kind of had to challenge a lot of assumptions. When we launched ability to talk to a doctor online, we kind of assumed that the data connectivity would be solved for us. But when we actually launched, we were seeing significant error rates, up to 20%. But then we moved our stack to cloud and to the MQTT protocol. After that, we saw significant success.
What are some of the other interesting areas that you want to take your product into?
Technically, two areas we are focusing on is on containerization and Kubernetes. And a lot of investment around AI/ML because we believe that it's going to kind of empower the whole ecosystem. We want to kind of personalize our app and website to who the user is. To give one example, we have health content. We don't want the same health content to be served to all users. For example, if you're a diabetic, we want to surface diabetes content for you. And we believe we can achieve that using AI/ML.
What's the future for Halodoc?
At Halodoc, we believe that we can use the power of technology to change healthcare in Indonesia. We are working with Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation We have about 40,000 midwives on our platform. We are building technology solutions to better enable midwives to give infant care in rural areas.
That's fantastic. A big vision, not just for Halodoc, but also for this great country. Abhilash, thank you so much for letting me share this day with your team and also with yourself.
Thanks a lot.
I've learned a lot here in the last couple of days, and the citizens of Indonesia are learning too.
With access to healthcare in rural areas so difficult to access, and with busy cities like this, Indonesians now have an option. Halodoc is changing things with its convenience and time savings. So if people did more of this, they can avoid a lot of that, saving lives in the process.